The controversial hate speech bill is back again and then again. Was it ever dead? The sponsor of the bill, Senator Abdullahi Sabi, has stated that the bill, which he believes Nigeria needs, is alive and continuing its journey to becoming a law. He, however, stated that the death penalty will be removed. He also said that without it, Nigeria stands to be next to Rwanda. What could he possibly mean? Joining us to discuss this are two gentlemen, or still with us in the studio, we have Kayode Soyebi. Thank you very much for staying. And we also have Jimmy Abia.
It's my pleasure being with you.
Thank you so much. All right. He's saying the bill is still very much alive. Does it come to you as a surprise, considering the controversy that that bill has generated?
Well, for the bill to be alive is not a problem. There are several bills, several suggestions, you know, that are still alive. What would determine whether the bill becomes an act is the will of the people of Nigeria. Of course, you expect that before the bill becomes an act, it will go through public hearings. Then it will also go to a vote in both chambers of the National Assembly. So there's no problem with it being alive with him. If he has a copy, he can keep it alive. But of course, it has to pass the test of acceptability to Nigerians before it becomes an act of the National Assembly.
Yes, some would say the fact that he mentioned that the death penalty will be expunged, he feels that that's where Nigerians have a lot of gross with the bill. Does that indicate somewhat that maybe they are showing some reaction to the controversy the bill has generated?
Well, for me, I feel that he doesn't really understand why Nigerians had said in the first instance that that bill should be thrown away. I don't think the creator of that bill actually understand why Nigerians, you know, kicked against that bill in the first instance. Because for me, any restriction about or on the freedom of expression or the freedom of opinions of Nigerians should be thwarted in its entirety. Nigerians should not be restricted to express themselves freely. This right has been contained, placed in the constitution of the country, and we should at every point in time have freedom to express ourselves, express our opinion. People spoke quite ill, a lot of hate in the U.S. People called Donald Trump quite a number of names. He never said he's going to, you know, he's going to gag them, you know, for what they're saying. I feel that he quite doesn't understand why we're saying we don't want this bill. And it's not because of the death penalty alone. We are saying that we should not be gagged. People should be given freedom to express themselves freely. Not to say that these are the penalties for you to call for calling. If someone express opinion freely, it shouldn't be, such a person shouldn't be penalized.
All right, let me bring Barrister Abia in. I'll still stay on the same question. Does it really matter, or do you think it's of much import that the death penalty was to be removed?
The problem with the bill is not just the death penalty. There are a number of things, several things. Okay, let me mention one of them. Now, how do you, first of all, no right is absolute, so we must understand that people have the right to freedom of expression. But of course, no right is absolute. Where your right ends is where that of another person begins. However, the issue with such a bill is that it creates room for people, for one person to determine the right of another. Now, that means that at what point, what speech would you
categorize
as hate speech? What would you categorize as hate speech? It talks about creating a hate speech, a commission for hate speech. Now, have you looked at the possible excesses of such a body? Because when you have such a body, there's also the likelihood of several excesses. And again, another issue is that there are also laws that deal with excesses in terms of speech. You have defamation provisions under our criminal justice system, under our criminal code. Then you also have the provisions made under the Cyber Crimes Act, also applicable in this country. Then you have other provisions within other laws where the speech you have made has led to certain other actions. You also have provisions within other laws. You also have the laws with respect to the media. You have laws, several other laws regarding the media. So I do not see the reason, the urgency at this time in this country for us to be having, to be creating, to be enacting a hate speech act.
Doesn't it worry you that this is a lawmaker who is representing a group of people in this country, and he is saying his words that Nigeria needs this bill? And he went on to say that if we do not get a bill like this, we stand the risk of becoming the Rwanda scenario. What could he possibly mean by that?
Well, if you check their antecedents, you find out that, unfortunately, bulk of our lawmakers are, unfortunately, selfish in the type of bills they pursue. Their bills, are they pro-people? Because if your bill is actually the bill supports the interests of the people, we wouldn't be here in the first instance. We will have been able to find out what are the yearnings of the people. If you check properly this bill, you find out that this bill tends to pursue their interests. And that's why they are looking for every ways to protect themselves, not to serve the people. Their job and mandate is to protect the interests of Nigerians, to protect the interests of their constituency. But I wonder, if you now gag the people from your constituency and tell them that there is a limit, just like Barrister had said, how do you differentiate what you call hate speech? It's a function of a lot of things that you can't measure. So what we should be talking at this point, what our interest should be, is how do we pass our electoral reform bill? Those are the things that actually should form the basis of our discussions at our Senate houses and our House of Representatives.
He talked about crisis and the rate, 80% to 90% of crisis in this country is as a result of came as a result of hate speech premised on religion, ethnicity, all of that. That's his position. I want to ask, do you agree with that submission?
I don't, 80%
to 90%?
I don't agree. 90% of our problems is caused by politicians. And if there's any bill that should be made, it should be targeted at politicians.
True.
Let me say this, that the problem with Nigeria has not been hate speech. Indeed, you will create more problem when you gag people, because the only way they can express themselves then will be through their fist. When a baby cannot fight, a baby cannot do anything, the baby cries because that baby is seeking expression. If you stop that ability to express, people from that ability to express themselves, then they may resort to other things. And it would be even worse for the country. The problem of the country, was it hate speech that caused the Boko Haram crisis? It is not hate speech that has prevented us from restructuring the country. It is not hate speech that is causing the security crisis that we have, the kidnappings, the other issues that we have in the country. It is not hate speech. So I think hate speech bill shouldn't be what should be on the front burner at this time. We have so many other issues to tackle in this country. We have issues of electoral reform, as my colleague has mentioned. We have issues of electoral reform that we should be talking about. And these are the things that would actually prevent crisis in the country, and not a hate speech bill.
Well, he says he expects more support for the bill, which we know has already passed first reading, right?
Yes.
Do you share that optimism, considering, I'm still staying with you, Barrister, considering the fact that a lot of Nigerians, both lawyers, activists, everybody has come up to say, this is not right for this nation. They seem not to be listening. But in the House? Do you see it going through second reading?
I do not see it succeeding. I do not see it succeeding. The reason why is because in enlightened self-interest, most of them will realize, most of them, after sleeping over it, will remember that they were probably not legislators 4 years ago, and they may not be legislators after 4 years. So they may not even be in the political scene after 4 years. So in enlightened self-interest, they would also want to protect themselves by ensuring that such a bill is not passed as an act.
Do you agree, Kayode?
Honestly, I doubt the possibility of that passing through. Honestly,
no, the man is, I mean, quite convinced that this bill is the right thing, and apparently he's going to pursue it.
He has the right to pursue whatever it is he desires to pursue. It's his right. And the question I would have asked him if I had the opportunity of seeing him is, how did he come about his analysis of 90% of his speech being the major
80,
problem?
90%,
you know, so people can come up with a lot of statistics just to convince, to put forward their narrative. But beyond that, we must sit down as a people to say, what is our problem? What do we need to move forward? Hate speech is the least of the concerns we have now. We just talked about Lassa fever. We talked about our medical system, the facilities we have. We talked about a lot of issues, NEPA, power, a lot of issues we should be making laws over, not hate speech. If we continue on this kind of saying, we want to restrict people on their opinion, freedom of expression, I wonder how, unfortunately, or rather fortunately for this government, it was, okay, time is up.
Your final thoughts, please.
My final thought is that on the issue of Lassa fever, I expect government to do more. I expect the Ministry of Health to champion this, and of course the Ministry of Information to champion this and ensure that there is proper awareness and that the relevant agencies, you know, come together to ensure that there is prevention, because prevention is the most important and even more critical. And then that people also are aware of the symptoms. So, and there is also a room for early reporting, of suspected cases. And then on the issue of a hate speech bill, I expect, like I said, that the National Assembly will not allow this to go through in their own enlightened self-interest. Yes.
In 30 seconds.
Yes. On the issue of the coronavirus and the other viruses, I feel that, and I pray that government will actually be more proactive, in reacting to this kind of situation. We shouldn't be reactive, basically. We should be proactive, basically. So I think beyond that, the arms of government should come together and find a lasting solution to ensuring that when scenarios like this happen, we are more prepared. Yes. And also on the hate speech, I don't see it going beyond the second reading.
All right. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for coming on the program tonight.
Thank you so much for having us.
Right, and thank you for staying with us. We'll go for our Plus package now, and when we return, I'll be giving you my take. Don't go away.
Of the institute, Mustafa said he is confident that with the board now in place, the capacity of the federal government to solve the myriad of security challenges bedeviling the nation has become richer.
With the tenacity of focus, and a burning desire to excel, I have no doubt that you can achieve the overall objective for the establishment of the Institute, namely making a difference and contributing to the security and stability of our dear country.
We recognize the fact that there are several challenges that are facing the nation. Our belief is that we can contribute to mitigating the various challenges that are facing the nation. So it is our intention really to nurture an institute that will be unlike the other institutions, because we intend to actively participate in the process of advising the government as well as enhancing professionalism in the various services.
I'm not going to talk about coronavirus. Why? Because we have Lassa fever now. How we handle it is an indication of our preparedness to fight any similar disease. And as it stands, much more needs to be done. Our guests have said as much. The Nigerian Medical Association has described the recent outbreak across the country as a reflection of the abysmally low level of preparedness in handling infectious diseases like this. While efforts by the NCDC at containment is commendable, more needs to be done. We need to increase the number of diagnostic centers. Five, while an improvement is still grossly inadequate for the population we have, considering the rapidness with which the infection spreads. There is also an urgent need for sustained public enlightenment about the virus and how to prevent it. This should not end when the dry season goes. As far as I'm concerned, Lassa fever is a national health primacy that needs to be addressed now. Many thanks for your time with us tonight. Please take time to check out our social media presence and share your thoughts on our programs. Your comments are always welcome. Until next time, I would say adios.